The New Girl, a trans girl tells it like it is. Written and read by Rhyannon Styles. My memoir is dedicated to Jackie, Nadia, Venus, the cast of my transsexual summer, and all the inspiring trans people I'm so lucky to have in my life, and anyone who believes in the potentiality of a different reality. Prologue. Introducing the New Girl. When I was young, I had a penchant for dressing up. One of my earliest cross-dressing memories is being age 6 and wearing my grandmother's heeled shoes. I would happily trot around the house pretending to be a waitress, serving food to my sister at the kitchen table. My nan's black leather shoes were 4 sizes too big and hung off my feet like huge boats. I called them my clompy shoes. My nan hated me wearing them, but I didn't care. It felt so good. My name is Rhyannon Styles, and I identify as a transgender woman. For those of you who don't know, trans, transgender and transsexual means identifying as a different gender than your assigned sex at birth. In many cases, some trans people don't identify or conform to a particular gender at all. High five. Are you with me? Let's start at the beginning. When I was born, I was assigned male because of my anatomy. Then it was presumed my gender would follow suit. Growing up, the labels of male, boy and man didn't always feel accurate. Yes, I had a penis, but did my body have to dictate how I lived my life? I didn't think so. In 2012, I'd had enough of pretending and started living. I changed roles to become the person I'd always wanted to be, and I let Rhiannon enjoy the limelight at last. It was a decision that had taken years to understand, and the consequences were massive. Today, I use the terms girl, she, and her to define who I am. I proudly use these words to clarify my identity. I don't know why I feel at home in a female identity. Over the years, I've interrogated myself, hoping to find an answer, but I keep coming up short. It just is. It wasn't a choice, and I've always felt this way. I grew up dissatisfied within myself, knowing that one day I would need to make a drastic, life-changing decision on how I was going to live my life. I just didn't know how or when it would happen. It took me 30 years until I was able to fully embrace living as Rhiannon. As I look back at my life, I believe I have always been the person I am today. Although before 2012, I wasn't able to express or articulate that fully. Being transgender was an abstract curiosity to me for so long. As a child, just like my female friends, I dressed up as the blue fairy from Pinocchio, the superhero She-Ra, and the twins from Funhouse. I raided my mum's wardrobe and makeup drawer, trying to fashion anything and everything into a colourful creation, and I felt so free when doing so. What began as a game touched something far deeper inside me. I couldn't see a difference between myself and the women I was creating. I knew there was more to explore. I continued to play female roles and felt at home in them, but I didn't know I was transgender. It's only now, living as the person I spent so long searching for, that I attach the word trans to my stories with pride. I was a person called Ryan, and throughout my life I tried. I tried really hard to feel comfortable within myself, but as a male, it wasn't always possible. I knew that when I wore female clothes, I felt different, but I didn't know why. Beyond the wardrobe, I related to girls much more than I did men. My sensitive emotions and penchant for dressing up were characteristics shared by my female friends. I couldn't see a difference. It was hard to translate who I was and how I felt in regard to my gender. Back then, I didn't know about gender dysphoria, a medical condition in which someone feels emotional distress, i.e. dysphoria, because there's a mismatch between their biological sex and their gender identity. And this was the reason why I felt like I did, the reason why I behaved the way I did. Whenever I expressed femininity, I was told it was unnatural. I suppressed my desires and urges, so much so that sometimes I completely forgot them. My younger self felt confused and disorientated. I wasn't allowed to express myself as I wanted to, and whenever I did, I was punished. Unbeknown to me, I was growing up within boundaries that my parents, their parents, and society wanted to enforce. There were rules on how females and males should behave in rural 1980s England. And there was a distinct difference between the sexes. If you crossed the invisible line, you were called names. I was the village queer, and that was bad. As a teenager, I began to identify my sexuality as gay. This allowed me to be femme, fabulous, and accepted in certain circles. I knew that identifying as gay wasn't the full story, but it was the closest option that encompassed how I felt. This identity felt comfortable for the next 15 years. It wasn't until much, much later that I began to see people like me that I could relate to. When Nadia won Big Brother in 2004, she was a transsexual being celebrated across the country, and this was radical to me. I immediately identified. I knew I was transgender too, an option that had previously been an impossibility to me. Before Nadia, the media portrayed transsexuals as horror stories, only suitable for trashy tabloids, sex scandals, and punchlines of bad jokes. This negative exposure left me thinking that being transgender was shameful and wrong. Men could only be women in pantomimes or when using drag to entertain. Transcending from male to female was beyond anything I could have imagined. I didn't know how or where to begin. In the end, the choice for me was simple. Live your life as a woman or die as a man. In 2015, I began video blogging and writing about my transgender experience in a regular column called The New Girl for Elle magazine. I absolutely love this job. I decided to unveil my life in Elle because I wanted my voice to be included in the wider consciousness and on a national platform. I want to raise awareness of trans people and I want to be visible as an equally accepted member of society. The positive feedback I received demonstrates just how far media attitudes have come since I was growing up. Take a look on Instagram and you'll find a global community of trans people supporting each other and collectively adding to the ongoing understanding that being transgender is actually cool. We share selfies with our stories to debunk old-fashioned, dated, and preconceived ideas that trans people are freaks. As individuals, we are smashing existing prejudice about who transsexuals are. We are not damaged people, nor should we be forced to live a lie. At the beginning of my transition, I saw female and male as being very opposite, opposed forces. I was one when I wanted to be the other. Navigating life as a trans woman has shown me a different perspective. I don't believe that gender is predetermined at birth, and I don't believe that gender should only be reduced to female and male. I think we need to acknowledge a potentiality that more possibilities exist. Finally, I've been conscious not to dress up these words with a pretty stylish bow. I simply want to honestly and faithfully recall my experience in this physical body since being born on the 17th of March 1982 and then born again in 2012. You know what I mean. The New Girl is my story. This is a memoir of self-discovery, self-acceptance and self-love. I want to invite you into my world. Being transgender is about being true to you. For the first 30 years of my life, I denied myself the opportunity to be me. It would be such a shame for anyone else to do the same. Chapter 1, The Lost Boy. Let me take you back to the 1980s. I've picked through the memories, some of them painful, some of them ridiculous, and some so vague that I had to ask my family to fill in the blanks. What I can recall is here, the highs and the lows, the clarity and the confusion, the girl and the boy. My childhood wasn't like everyone else's, unless you are trans too, in which case you'll probably relate to nearly everything. But for everyone else, this is what it is like growing up and not knowing who you are or the person you want to be. I often switch between the roles of girl and boy in my head, unsure which one felt more secure. These memories are tough and painful to recollect. I dodged flying potatoes and collected butterflies as I tried to navigate and understand my gender and find a place where I felt comfortable. Quite often, the only place of comfort was to be found in my own head. Within this safe space, I indulged in fantasy, the only escape from the reality of my life. The voice in my head told me one thing, and then society told me another. I was constantly watching over my shoulder and lived in fear. I didn't grow up comforted by wealth and security. My West Midlands village was rural and down to earth. The people in it were honest and traditional. They held family values at heart, and a great sense of community prevailed. I had a friend called Jamie who lived around the corner. Together, we'd play in my garage and build dens using old curtains and dusty deck chairs. Jamie encouraged me to steal eyeliners from my mum, who was a big fan of Avon Cosmetics. I remember being in awe of her dressing table, which was covered in lipsticks and jewellery. She was always perfectly groomed, and I remember she fashioned her brown hair into a wonderful 80s style at the time. Using her brown and blue pencils, we drew spots and stripes all over our bodies to imitate our favourite characters from the cartoon, Thundercats. I liked to pretend I was Chitara as we jumped around the garage, smothered in makeup, trying to save each other from imaginary baddies. I had a He-Man and the Masters of the Universe duvet cover that had all the characters from the cartoon printed on it. I loved the characters She-Ra and the Sorceress of Castle Grayskull. I related to them much more than I did with the image of He-Man. To me, they were so much more representative of how I felt at the time. No matter what game I played with my friends, I was always the female character. I was Rogue from X-Men, Daphne in Scooby-Doo, and the Power Ranger who wore pink. My favourite Disney film was Pinocchio. I was in awe of the Blue Fairy. I adored how she magically appeared from inside a ball of light and sparkled whenever she moved. The Blue Fairy ignited my imagination and I started to dress like her, or as best I could. My mum had a long blue-green skirt in her wardrobe, which I used to steal. I would pull the skirt up under my armpits and pretend it was a dress. I didn't have long hair, so I wore my red toweling pyjama bottoms on top of my head and wrapped the legs into a twist which hung down in a childish imitation of hair. I didn't look anything like the Blue Fairy, but I felt wonderful as I floated around the house and tapped my dog on the nose with a wooden spoon, pretending to cast spells. One day, I left the house dressed in my fairy costume, jumping off the neighbour's walls and pretending to be a dazzling ball of light. I remember the Clark boys from up the road driving past me in their car. They immediately wound down the window, pointing and laughing at me. I couldn't blame them. I was putting on a great show. When my mum saw me, she told me to go back inside the house. I couldn't understand why. I hadn't done anything wrong. I was happy pretending to be a fairy and making the world a better place. On warm summer days, I collected ladybirds and butterflies. I'd explore all of my neighbours' gardens and try to catch them. Once successful, I'd seal them into a jar with a couple of holes drilled in the lid. I'd keep the jars in my room at night and I'd briefly let the butterflies out to fly around before going to sleep. The insects only stayed alive for a couple of days. I didn't know what butterflies ate, so I didn't feed them anything. By the end of the summer, I had a nice collection of dead butterflies wrapped in toilet tissue and stuffed into matchboxes. I was mesmerised by their bright colours and patterns on their wings. I took great enjoyment from them, dead or alive. I have a sister who is 2 years younger than me called Danielle. Unlike me, she was a natural redhead who loved pickled onion flavour Monster Munch crisps. When we were kids, she'd have all the toys I wanted, but was too afraid to ask for. On Saturday mornings, we'd mix up the Lego and the Cindy dolls while watching Going Live. I enjoyed combing her dolls' hair and deciding what outfits they were going to wear. This was the late 80s and Cindy wore amazing outfits. I remember bright yellow stiletto pumps, pink puffer jackets and leotards. My sister also owned a fashion wheel, which I loved to play with whenever I had the chance. I could quite happily sit for hours in the living room amusing myself in this way. And often my sister and I would still be in our pyjamas mid-afternoon. The village I grew up in was an idyllic playground all year round. Great Heyward in Staffordshire wasn't posh by any means, though in many ways you might believe that by walking around it. The isolated village makes for a pretty postcard of rural England, filled with old houses, National Trust halls and heritage status buildings. On the flip side, it's very heteronormative and traditional, which didn't suit me one bit. The boys around the village didn't like me. They were jealous of my relationships with the girls. I was much closer to the popular girls than they could ever be, and I became an honorary member of the girl gangs. At primary school, I remember standing behind my teacher, hidden, when I heard the school nurse ask, "Where's Ryan?" My teacher responded, "Probably with the girls, as always." Although she was wrong that time, I could agree with her. You could always find me doing handstands against the wall with the girls. I was an insider in the female domain. I had access to all the gossip and secrets. I knew who was writing love letters to whom, which girl had started their period, and which member of Take That was considered hot. I was allowed in girls' bedrooms when other boys weren't. I didn't know why this was. I presumed it was because I devoured their copies of the magazine Just 17 like they did. In the school holidays, my girl gang and I would play in the woods, making rope swings from the tall trees and cooling off by swimming in the river. I wasn't actually allowed to swim in the river. My mum considered it too dirty, but I couldn't help myself. The refreshing water was too alluring. That said, even I had to admit it didn't always look very appealing. Once, there was a dead cow floating on the weir. The heifer was stuck in the water for over a week and became very bloated. All the children tried to pop the inflated cow's belly, jabbing it with sticks and rocks. After seeing the dead animal slowly rot away, I promised my mum I'd never swim in the river again. There are two primary schools in Great Heyward. One is Catholic and the other is Church of England. I attended the latter. I didn't believe in God. I was told he was a man, and I was instantly appalled. My mum described herself as an atheist, which I knew meant she didn't believe in God. Her motto was, "You'll only see me in church for a wedding or a funeral," and I agreed. Besides, churches were freezing. Back then, I thought being an atheist sounded wonderfully exotic. I preferred to go against the grain whenever possible. I decided at 7 years old that Jesus and his gang were only fun when I could dress up as them for the school Christmas nativity. Even then, I couldn't be the angel that I wanted to be, a perfect example of the times. I didn't like how gendered everything had to be at primary school, especially when it came to PE. I wasn't allowed to play netball, the girls' sport, which really annoyed me because all of my friends played it. I had a penis, so I was forced to play football and cricket with the people that bullied me. It was horrible. The only time the boys and girls mixed was rounders on the school field in the summer or gym inside the assembly hall when it was raining. Gym consisted of various equipment left over from the 1970s. There was a climbing rope which burned your hands every time you slid down it, and a wooden frame with two long metal poles that you were supposed to do somersaults around, a task that many failed, leading to several nosebleeds. Then there was the horse, the purpose of which to this day I still don't understand. For a chubby six-year-old, it only caused further embarrassment in front of your classmates. If you couldn't jump onto it with the help of the springboard, you were ridiculed. The only fun bit was jumping onto the bright blue crash mat, which only went so far in cushioning the impact of being called a fairy by my peers. Did they know I used to dress up as one? The first time I met people from a different ethnicity was while I was at primary school. My class went to visit another school near Stoke-on-Trent. It was predominantly Asian and it came as a big culture shock. I really liked the young Sikh boys who wore fabric over their hair. I didn't know what any of it meant, but I was fascinated by the bright colours and the little bun that sat on top of their heads. As part of the school exchange, we were encouraged to swap food. I reluctantly handed over my cheese sandwiches on white bread, only to receive the same back. This experience had a massive impact on me. Their sudden presence ignited my imagination, especially as it seemed the boys were allowed to have long hair, a radical concept to me. My eyes were open to a world beyond my village, and I was curious to learn more. Before this, I thought that people who weren't white were bad, because this is what I was told growing up. My village was so isolated, it was backwards and prejudiced. People were ignorant and racist, and these prejudices were passed down through the generations. As such, they were passed on to me, and I didn't know any different. But visiting this school changed everything. I could no longer believe what I'd been told. To me, it was obvious that the young boys and girls were exactly the same as us, cheese sandwiches and all, except they wore more earrings and bursts of bright colours. I realised there was nothing different about them at all, and this is when I first began to question the voice of adults and when I started to interrogate the norm. Another school trip also left a huge impression on me. I remember it for one reason. It was the first time I saw a punk. Technically, she wasn't a punk, as this was the late 80s, and she'd mixed in a slightly more new romantic vibe, but nonetheless, I was enthralled. My class went for a day trip to Twycross Zoo in Leicestershire. I clocked her leaning against the llama enclosure, smoking a cigarette and looking like she didn't want to be there. Her hair was projecting off her head in green spikes, and she wore a sleeveless denim jacket covered in patches and a shiny black PVC skirt. Her makeup was like nothing I'd seen before. Her eyes were completely blacked out like a panda, and her lipstick was dark red. Again, I'd been told that punks were bad. My granddad used to say, "waste of space," whenever anyone of a younger generation appeared to be experimenting with clothes. But I had long since learned to distrust the conventional views of adults. In everyone else's eyes, the punks were trash, but I thought she was amazing. She was the closest thing I'd seen which resembled the cartoon characters I loved and identified with. I thought about my dear He-Man bedspread and how she could easily join the ranks of attractive women. The best thing about seeing her at the zoo was observing how much she stuck out. Her attitude of not caring shone through, and I was drawn to it. I didn't see anyone else like that again until I was a teenager. My parents separated when I was 4 years old. I remember waking up in the night and going to the toilet. I walked past my mum and dad's bedroom, and through the crack in the door, I saw my mum sat on the end of the bed crying and my dad hugging her. Something felt wrong. It was confusing and disorientating in many ways for my sister and me. We didn't know what was happening and were too young for it to be explained. I have few memories of living with my father as a child. My dad was the man of the house and he liked to enforce rules, often making me clear my plate before being allowed to leave the table. Dad worked for an electrical firm in Stafford and liked to ride his motorbike to work. I remember him sitting on the kitchen step, smoking rollies as bacon hissed and popped under the grill. We'd eat bacon sarnies drenched in brown sauce and religiously watch Bullseye together every Saturday afternoon. These sparse moments were precious. Their marriage broke down because my dad had begun a relationship with a different woman. At the age of 4, I couldn't comprehend the fact that my dad had a girlfriend,
and my parents' relationship was over. As the years progressed, I felt incredibly embarrassed about my home situation and carried a lot of shame around it for years to come. Not only did my gender feel unresolved, but my home life did too. After the divorce, my dad settled in the next village. He remarried and some years later had two sons, my stepbrothers Adam and Matthew. I hated going backwards and forwards from house to house. I felt like I was split in two, living two very different lives. This has been a reoccurring theme for me. As part of the court agreement, my sister and I attended child counselling sessions run by the local health service. Every week, the counsellor liked to play a game with buttons as an initial exercise. I'd have to choose a button which represented each member of my family and one for myself. I would put my button, which was the most fabulous button I could find, in the middle of the table and everyone else's buttons around me. The more I liked them, the closer I placed them. It didn't make much sense to me at the time, just adding to an incredibly confusing period of my life, although in hindsight, I can understand why I was asked to do this. I don't remember talking much at these sessions. Instead, I painted pictures of how I saw myself. I always drew myself how I desperately wanted to be, with long, beautiful hair. After my parents separated, there was a void in the house. We all felt it. My mum worked as a kitchen assistant, so she often brought sweet treats home for my sister and me. After school, I could gorge myself on endless bowls of cream, custard, and chocolate mousse. I lapped it up. I was comfort eating because my surroundings were so uncomfortable. Little did I know then that I was using food to escape my reality, and when I consumed sugar, I felt good. As a result, I was a chubby child. I'll always remember my friend's mother exclaiming, "God, you're always eating," when I called for Adam eating a king-size Mars bar. We lived in a semi-detached three-bedroom house in one of the three estates in my village. My sister and I supported my mother around the house whenever possible, even if we hated doing chores. There was plenty to do, ranging from hoovering, washing up, and walking the dog. Our house was freezing in the winter because we had a coal fire which constantly needed attention. Every morning I'd be woken up by the sound of Mum cleaning out the fireplace and getting ready to start another one. Once a week, the coal man arrived, delivering big dirty sacks of coal into our back garden's bunker. It was my job to go out into the frosty night and carry shovels of coal into the front room alongside the logs to feed the fire. It's strange to think about real fires now, but back then most people had one, and it wasn't an aesthetic choice. Neither was the cling film we'd cover the windows with every winter. My mum would spend hours heating up the plastic with a hairdryer, trying to get the creases out. The translucent film stretched into place around the window frames, and I couldn't stop myself from poking it. When Freddie Boswell came along, my sister and I were beside ourselves with excitement. Freddie Boswell was a small, black, scruffy poodle, which my grandparents bought for us during the immediate months after my mum and dad's separation. Fred was my new best friend, and he stayed with me right up until I left home aged 18. Fred and I had a real bond. He filled a gaping hole in my life. Whenever I skived off school pretending to be sick because I didn't want to do PE, Fred would sleep next to me on my bed all morning. When I was a teenager, I used Fred as an excuse to go outside and smoke. We'd go for walks in the evenings down to the bypass, just so I could secretly chain smoke three or four cigarettes. Fred was a great companion and one of the only constants in my life. I could always be my truest self with him and he would never judge me. I revelled in the unconditional love. Fred died when I was at university. After months of suffering, I was relieved his pain was over. Looking back, I was happy to have had him in my life for as long as I did. I'll never forget how he helped me through all the turbulent years. My mum's first boyfriend after her divorce was called Tony. When Tony came on the scene, I wasn't comfortable with a male identity around the house, especially when he assumed authority and told my mum what I should be doing. I had grown to like our arrangement and didn't want it changing. I was still too young to understand relationships and the need for people to continue with their lives. One afternoon, I was bird watching from the kitchen window and Tony appeared. I was happy peering out at the back garden and writing down how many blackbirds, robins or wrens I'd seen. I liked looking in books at different species and trying to draw them, but Tony had other ideas. He said to my mum, "Ryan should be doing boys' things or playing outside." Instead of being encouraged to watch birds and collect butterflies, I was given a sabutio. Sabutio is a game where you flick miniature footballers around a green felt tablecloth for reasons unbeknown to me. I hated it. Up until then, my only experience of it was at boys' birthday parties. Although the boys in school weren't always my friends, I'd be invited to their birthday parties by default. It looked worse if you didn't ask me. I was the chubby, femme-acting boy that befriended your mum and the cheese hedgehog at the buffet table. I couldn't care less about the Sabutio tournament that was going on in the living room. It was so boring. I wanted to talk about clothes, hair, and pop stars. With the arrival of Tony and Sabutio, I was whisked into a furore of football. I played along and tried to be enthusiastic whenever I could because it made life easier for others. I would constantly have to make compromises to make others feel more comfortable. I decided that I needed the disguise of supporting a football team, so I chose Manchester United because that was Tony's team. Whenever we could afford it, I would go to Man U games with Tony. One of the benefits of having Tony around was that he had a car, so we visited more places. Tony would drive us both up to Manchester and we'd watch the matches. Before the game, we'd sneak into a pub where lots of other Man U supporters would gather. This was a typical football pub, full of beer bellies, loud, foul language and St George's flags. I crawled inside, not wanting to be noticed. Tony sat there nursing his pint in silence while I slowly sipped my flat Coke and played with the straw. I avoided going to the toilet because it was too embarrassing. I couldn't bring myself to go into the filthy cubicle and I didn't like the idea of using the urinal either. It was too masculine and I shied away from it. Instead, I sat down to wee, which felt normal to me. Once or twice, a fight broke out in the pub. All credit to Tony, he quickly got me out of the way. This was the first time I witnessed male aggression and behaviour in its extreme form, and I was repelled by it. Being surrounded by men singing football chants in the terraces became my worst nightmare, especially as I was always dying for the toilet. I was bored and unstimulated. I didn't know the football lingo, so I couldn't talk about team tactics, corners or penalties. It just wasn't in my vocabulary. My mum left Tony just as I was starting high school. It was the news I'd been waiting for. In contrast, her future partner and fiancé, Ian, only takes me to Alton Towers. We're both thrill seekers and we love sitting at the front of rides, white-knuckling together. The only thing I liked about those football trips was getting lost around the Manchester Ring Road, trying to find our way home in the dark. Through the misty car window, the wet concrete pavements reflected flashes of electric shop signs in writing I didn't understand. I saw people, lots of people, eating chips and sheltering under umbrellas. These were my first glimpses of city life, going about its business and sweeping past me as I headed towards the M6 and home. These fragments saturated my imagination and gave rise to a desire to explore the world beyond the confines of my village. I knew there was more to experience than countryside, nosy neighbours and football. I loved northern seaside towns for the same reason. It gave me a glimpse of another world. Blackpool was the prime destination every year. It was all about chips, chips, and more chips, with a glass of milk on the side. A week in Blackpool as a child was exhilarating. You had to battle through the crowds being swept down the promenade by the ferocious North Sea wind. I enjoyed walking around at night when the piers glimmered and shone, stretching into the vast expanse of black water. I loved the drama, the glitz, and the colours. A sense of danger surrounded this small, illuminated town. I didn't know if I was going to get washed away by a giant wave smashing at the seafront or picked up and carried away by a seagull the size of a swan. It made me feel alive. My grandparents often took my sister and me on day trips to Rhyl. Grandad used to say, first one to see the sea gets a pound. But we never dipped a toe in the waves because it was icy cold and a mucky brown colour. We were always desperate to go into the Sun Centre, a heated indoor water park with slides and a wave pool. It was rough around the edges and dirty, but this only added to its charm. I remember swimming past a chip and a plastic fork once. It wasn't quite the tropical paradise I was hoping for, but it was better than anywhere else I'd been. The Sea Life Centre was another attraction, complete with bellowing sea lions, awkwardly stuck in a concrete enclosure surrounded by seagulls. On a hot day, the experience was wonderful. More often than not, it was cold and the enclosure smelt of fish. At home, during the summer holidays, I would hang out with the girls in the woods near our house. There was a tree in the forest which we called the pygmy tree. Its trunk was a collage of carved hearts, acneed with initials declaring love. It was here, aged 11, that I tried my first cigarette, which wasn't a cigarette at all. It was a rolled-up double-mint chewing gum wrapper which the older girls pretended was a cigarette. Smoking paper wasn't pleasant, but we felt so cool pretending it was. The boys at school and around the village picked up on my femininity. It threatened them. One day I was called Rachel by an older boy. Before I knew it, Rachel had become my new nickname. When I was down at the shops with my nan or at the fruit farms picking strawberries, I'd hear, "Hi Rachel, you puffed her." I couldn't escape it. The name calling was so embarrassing. Not only was I Rachel, I was also a puff. And puff is a poor man's term for a homosexual. I was being labelled before I'd even worked any of it out for myself. What started out as a joke slowly developed into a constant stream of bullying at school and around the village. At the time, I felt like the only kid in the world being targeted. But I now know that I was not alone. According to a study commissioned by the Home Office, roughly 70% of children that experience confusion about their gender identity are bullied at school. Certainly I faced my share of trouble. I was punched in the face at school by a boy because he thought I fancied him. I had to go to A&E because my eye had swollen up and I felt dizzy. When the teachers quizzed me about it, I lied. I didn't want to cause any more trouble. Another time, I was chased around the Uplands housing estate by a boy who kept throwing potatoes at me. Thankfully, I could run faster than him, so I managed to escape unhurt. But although it might sound funny in retrospect, it was incredibly frightening at the time. Years later, I asked him why he always carried potatoes in his pockets. He told me that his parents used to lock all the food cupboards in the kitchen, so he and his brother ate the raw potatoes from the garden shed. I never knew if he was telling the truth. This particular boy loved Kylie Minogue, and not long after the potato-throwing incident, I told him that I'd spotted Kylie down at the boatyard. Little did I know that one day I would be performing with her. He ran all the way down the road to the canal in the hope that it was true. I kept out of his way for a long time after that, but it felt good knowing I got my own back. I was particularly pleased that Kylie had performed part of my revenge plan. I knew the boys were confused by me and they behaved differently towards me. For example, when a fight broke out, unless they really wanted to hurt me, they wouldn't touch me. Instead, I'd watch all the other boys get beaten up while I stood on the sidelines with the girls, smoking cigarettes. In essence, the boys saw me as a girl too. If they did try and throw a punch at me, then one of the big girls would step in and protect me. One way I dealt with the constant bullying was by immersing myself in arts and crafts. Through my friend Alex, I'd heard that an older woman around the corner was hosting craft evenings every Thursday night in her dining room for a handful of local children. Alex and I went along one evening, creating outfits to dress up a wooden spoon. It was a few weeks away from the annual village fete, and we would enter our spoons into the best dressed spoon competition. Alex was turning her spoon into a wizard, and I made mine into Wurzel Gummidge, the scarecrow. After weeks of preparation, I didn't win the competition, but I did come second. I liked going to Mrs. G's house. For 20p, you could have biscuits and juice halfway through the evening. One week, I made a picture of a killer whale jumping out of the ocean using collage. My mum turned that image into a cake for my 9th birthday. It was the best cake ever. My mum, a highly skilled craftswoman, did an amazing job cutting up the icing to look just like the original whale. But I wasn't allowed in Mrs. G's craft club for very long. After 3 months, I was told to leave. Mrs. G said, "I think it would be better if you went and played with the lads on the green instead of coming here." I didn't think her comment was fair, but at such a young age, I was powerless to rebel against her. I had to accept her words. I was distraught to be banned from the club just because I was a boy. I liked playing with glitter, sequins, and wooden spoons. I belonged there. I wasn't doing any harm, but once again, my behaviour was simply a problem for somebody else. The next week, I admitted defeat and played with the lads on the green. I was rubbish at football. I was always put in goal as an excuse for them to kick balls at me really hard. It was obvious that I wasn't one of the lads, but I couldn't be one of the girls either. I didn't know what I should do or who I could trust. I felt utterly lost. When living became tough, I used fantasy to escape my reality. I liked to be on my own because I didn't upset anyone and I felt safe. When I was alone, I couldn't offend others with my behaviour and choices. I was allowed to be free. In the early 90s, I loved Saturday night TV. I'd sit on the sofa with my chip shop dinner, dipping my battered sausage into a polystyrene cup filled with bright green mushy peas, while watching people wearing tight-fitting lycra climbing walls and hanging from hoops. In the iconic game show Gladiators, I would thrill when the host announced, "Contenders, are you ready? Gladiators, are you ready?" Cobra, Hunter, and Warrior were firm favourites of mine with their ripped physiques and terrible 90s hair. I've actually still got Cobra's autograph. I met him while I was queuing for the Thunderlooper roller coaster at Alton Towers and my jaw hit the floor. Of course, he wasn't nearly as big as he appeared on TV. I didn't want to believe he was just a human being whose real name was Mick Wilson. On screen, Cobra was a high-kicking sex bomb who made my stomach feel funny. This was an early indicator that masculinity intrigued me sexually, but I was too young to really understand that I was attracted to it. Cobra wasn't the only guy who caught my eye. There was a boy in the village who was 4 years older than me. I thought he was really cool and I admired him. At the end of the 1980s, he was wearing baggy, Madchester-style clothes and wore his hair in curtains, which was a typical boy's haircut at the time. By the start of the 90s, he looked more like Kurt Cobain with longer, shaggy blonde hair, ripped jeans and tie-dye hoodies. His name was Tom. I asked him what the name of his haircut was, so I could have the same when I went to the barber's. He told me it was called a crew cut. The next time I went to the barber's, I asked for what Tom had told me, hoping to have beautiful hair like him. To my horror, the barber shaved it all off. I cherished my long hair and spent hours brushing it before school every morning. I'd been growing it for months and it was buzzed off in a matter of seconds. It wasn't a crew cut that Tom wore so well. It was an undercut. I'd been tricked. My hair was like a safety net to me. It was how I expressed myself, and without it, I felt naked and exposed. At home that night, I cried when I looked in the mirror. I hated how I looked, and I hated myself as a result. It took months to grow my hair back and feel happy again. I despised male-dominated spaces, the barber's being a prime example. The barber I frequented was on the outskirts of a nearby town called Rugeley. Thick velvet curtains hung in the windows, making the wood-panelled interior intense and dark. Stepping inside demanded courage. When I opened the door and walked in, I was instantly engulfed by a cloud of blue cigarette smoke. A line of working-class white men covered in faded tattoos sat on a bench, waiting to go through the beaded curtain and sit in the barber's chair. Old copies of the magazine Viz, with torn covers, were strewn on the table between the overflowing ashtrays. When I was allowed to go to the barber's on my own, I remember feeling very grown up, but completely intimidated by all the men around. I never felt comfortable, but I loved looking at the concoctions of products on the dusty workstations. Bubble-filled tubs of bright green wet-look gel, glass jars glowing with blue water, and rows of bright red Brill Cream containers distracted me from the awkwardness of the situation. Instead, I really wanted to be in a hairdresser's. I longed to sit under the hairdryers with my hair in rollers and sipping a cup of tea, preferably with my nan. Whenever I went clothes shopping, I was always more enamoured by the girls' section. The displays were brighter, cooler and more fun. In comparison, the boys' section looked dull, bland and boring. It was so disheartening to have to sift through piles of blue jeans or black sweatshirts. Rows and rows of desert-style boots in camel colours covered the walls. Nothing spoke to me. The whole environment made me feel sick and confused. Occasionally, I would befriend boys, and in these cases, I started to become exactly like them. I didn't have a natural male identity of my own, and I couldn't magically summon one, so I had to borrow from others. I found myself asking for the same clothes they had and trying to behave like them, mirroring their every movement. When all the boys started to wear shiny NAFCO 54 jackets, I was desperate to get one, just so I could fit in. I did own one for a short time, but when it became apparent that I wanted to plait my hair instead, the jacket didn't seem to fit anymore. Pop music, like Kraft, was a salvation from how I was feeling. The first album I bought on cassette tape was Bad by Michael Jackson. I was fascinated by Michael Jackson. His flamboyance, attitude, and white socks spoke to me. He was stylish, cool, and gloriously weird. He didn't seem real. He was like one of the many fantasy cartoon characters I adored and wished to be. At that age, I didn't understand the politics surrounding his identity and image. I simply took him at face value. I loved the front cover of Bad. I was struck by his leather jacket and his curly hair. I wore that cassette tape out, and eventually the tape player chewed it up. Every morning before school, I would play Man in the Mirror over and over again, singing along into my hairbrush. When I looked at my reflection and saw Ryan staring back at me, I accepted my lot because I hadn't heard that you could transition, and I told myself that I couldn't be a girl no matter how good I felt when I dressed like one. And I didn't know how to tell people how I truly felt, so I kept it all bottled up inside. With no means to identify myself as transgender and a total lack of any information, I carried on regardless. Do you remember the neon fashion trend of the early 90s? People wore orange, pink and yellow neon socks, teamed with toweling wristbands and headbands. Personally, I wasn't interested. It was too garish for me then, even if some of my later outfits as Rhiannon were on the same crazy scale. I didn't have the courage to pull it off first time round. A girlfriend and I went to the fair in Milford one weekend, and trails of neon flashed before my eyes as I rode the waltzes while Rhythm is a Dancer by Snap blasted out from the music system. I laughed so hard that I was crying and I couldn't see clearly. I loved being rendered powerless by the waltzes and spun into a dizzy frenzy. Those 4 minutes spent spinning around, making my belly feel completely crushed, was one of the happiest moments of my life. In those days, health and safety was non-existent. We were always pushed terrifically fast by the boys managing the ride, who completely fascinated my girlfriends and me. Others in the village had an attitude of, "Don't talk to the gypsies at the fair, they will put a spell on you." But unlike everyone else, they didn't wear neon, and I very much wanted them to work their magic on me. I longed to be transformed into something else by the mysterious boys. One thing I wished to be turned into was a beautiful mermaid. As soon as I saw Daryl Hannah in the film Splash, I wanted to be her. I longed for her hair, her tail, and the ability to swim so gracefully. I loved how she kept her identity hidden and pretended that she was just a normal girl. Ring any bells? I loved everything aquatic and dreamed of becoming a marine biologist. For starters, I joined the National Society for the Protection of Whales and Dolphins. Off my own back, I would.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.